In this lecture, we're going to go over some basic chemistry that you need to understand any subject in biology or anatomy. Now, you may be wondering, why do you need to study chemistry when you're taking a life science course? Well, organisms are chemistry. Everything about us, from our tissues and our organs to the metabolic reactions that go on in our body, it goes back to chemistry. And there are two main types of chemistry that we're going to study in the life sciences. Some basic chemistry, which is the topic of this lecture, and biochemistry, which is what we'll talk about in the next one. So again, the human body is chemistry. All organisms on Earth are chemistry. Our organs, as you've learned, are made up of tissues. Tissues are made up of cells, and cells are made up of molecules, which are made up of atoms. So in this lecture, we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of how all that comes together and some of the terminology you need to know and the processes you need to know to understand how chemicals will react with each other to produce tissues and ultimately organisms. So all the physiological reactions of the body are in fact chemical reactions. And therefore, we can thank chemistry for all the processes we do, such as moving and digesting, pumping things through our heart, sending signals through our nervous system. And all of the breakthroughs in the medical industry are thanks to our understanding of chemistry and biochemistry. So whether it's understanding the root causes of a disease or being able to treat that disease, we need to have a fundamental understanding of how atoms and molecules and compounds interact with each other to produce products. An example is understanding the basis of dehydration, and that has to do with balance of electrolytes in our body fluids. And so without an understanding of chemistry, you wouldn't be able to find what the problem is and address it through treatment. Now, by this point in your educational career, you're probably come across the periodic table of elements. So this is a chart that chemists use to categorize all the elements of the universe, really. So everything, whether it's a biological organism like us, or it's an inanimate object like a rock or a table, everything is made up of combinations of elements, which are these things that you see illustrated with little blocks and letter signs, different elements of this periodic table. And to date, there have been 118 elements of the periodic table discovered, and 92 of those are naturally occurring, and the other 26 are synthetic, human-made. So we're going to break down this table specifically for the elements of this table that are important for understanding life's processes and organisms, including humans. So we're going to be sticking mainly to the left side of this table, and over here, on the right side of the table. That's where you'll find the elements that are most important to life, which we'll go over in just a second. So, in as amazing as life is, as diverse as all the organisms of the earth are, ranging from humans and bacteria, trees, worms, whatever you have it, we're all made up of the same elements of the periodic table, and that's very few of those 118 elements. In fact, we can coin a little term called chomps to describe the elements that are most important to life on Earth. So CHOMPS stands for carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur, CHOMPS. And so we're gonna see that hydrogen is element number one of the periodic table. It'll be all the way over on the left side. Carbon is element number six, and it'll be on the right side. So this picture here is taking that periodic table you saw on the previous slide, kind of getting out the middle and squashing it together. Here is oxygen, element number eight on the right side. Nitrogen is sandwiched between carbon and oxygen at element number seven. Here's phosphorus, element number 15, and sulfur is element number 16. So those few elements make up the bulk of everything that composes the body of humans and every other organism on Earth. And in fact, out of those, it's mainly the four elements, carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, and nitrogen. So with this picture right here, you can kind of see a relative abundance of each of those four elements in the body. So the most abundant of that would be oxygen at 65%, which is not a surprise because our bodies are mostly water. Water is H2O, so you're going to find a whole lot of oxygen in there. Carbon makes up about 18.5% of our bodies. Hydrogen 9.5% and nitrogen 3.3%. So most of that, those four elements make up the human body and the bodies of all organisms on Earth, whether a plant or a worm or bacterial cell. We're all made of the same stuff. Now, the remaining 4% are what we call trace elements. And these may come in very small quantities, but they are very vital to survival as well. And as you go through your life science studies, you're going to find that some of these elements have important functions in mediating how chemical reactions in the body occur. They serve maybe as cofactors or ions that are important for life's processes. So some of these would include, for example, calcium, potassium. You know, we already talked about phosphorus and sulfur being a part of that CHOMPS. Sodium and chlorine, very important for things like, for example, how to get signals across our neurons to make pretty much every movement in our body happen, magnesium, etc. So we'll be touching on these as you continue your studies, but I just think it's amazing that despite the who knows how many species on Earth, maybe it's millions, and the complexity we have, like look how complex a human is, despite that, it's very few elements of the periodic table that make us up. We have talked about the periodic table a little bit, 118 elements, 92 of those are natural, 26 are synthetic. But what are they exactly? Well, these elements are the purest form of what we call matter. And you've probably heard the term matter before. Like, have you heard the term nothing can be created nor destroyed? That's because matter is in its purest form. And if you destroy an element of matter that you would find, for example, on the periodic table, you either will change the type of matter it is, you'd change the element that you're dealing with, or you'd create like a nuclear explosion. So matter is anything that has mass and takes up space, and it's made of atoms. And atoms come in the form of elements of those, the periodic table, those 118 elements that we talked about, 92 of them being natural. So when you take any two of these elements, these atoms of the periodic table, and you put them together, what you've created is something called a molecule. So molecules, two or more elements held together in fixed proportions by chemical bonds. And an obvious example would be what you see over here that looks like Mickey Mouse, because these are molecules of water. And so it looks like Mickey Mouse because the face of Mickey Mouse is one atom of oxygen, and the ears of Mickey Mouse would be two atoms of hydrogen. So that would be a molecule of water, H2O. For every two atoms of hydrogen, you have one atom of oxygen. So that's called a molecule. And specifically, a molecule of water would be an example of a compound, because a compound is where there are two or more different elements held in those fixed proportions. Whereas a molecule in its purest sense wouldn't be two different elements, it would be two of the same element or more. So for example, two hydrogens together would be H2 gas. So that would be a pure molecule in by its literal definition. If you had H2O, you now have two different elements, and so that is technically a compound. But you hear the terms molecules and compounds used interchangeably often in life science courses, but I just want you to be aware that there is a distinction. Molecules, you're talking usually about two or more of the same element, and compounds, two or more of different elements. Now, if you've ever studied matter, you've probably also learned that matter can come in different forms or different states: solid, liquid, gas. Those are the ones we commonly think of, but there actually are up to two other forms called plasma and that kind of stuff we'll leave to the physicists. For the purposes of studying life, we're interested in the forms of solid, liquid, or gas. So let's talk about these for a minute. And you see here an example of a bunch of molecules or compounds that are in solid form. This is an ice structure. So this would be taking those compounds of water molecules and putting them in a fixed structure. So solids have a definite shape and a definite volume. And so it's very difficult to change that shape without changing the state. So solids come in a definite shape and a definite volume, whereas a liquid, and this is liquid water here, liquid, you can easily change the shape, right? If I took a glass of water and stuck my fist in it, I would change the shape of that water and then pulled my fist out and it would change shape again. However, the volume does not change. So it has a definite volume while the shape can change. A gas, on the other hand, can change both volume and shape. So look here. This would be, for example, how the atoms would be arranged in a solid. They're very fixed, and therefore they're not going to change shape. Their volume is also very fixed. liquid, they're a little looser, a little further apart, and so it's easy to change shape, but the volume is still going to be held constant. Whereas a gas, the atoms are going to be very dispersed, and you can easily change the shape or the volume. Now, we have matter out there, but life would have never gotten started if matter just hung out and did nothing. So we have to do something with that matter. And in order to do something with that matter, we have to have energy. Now, nobody can really see energy. All we can do is measure the effects of energy. And we can do that in different ways. But in general, we're going to define energy as the capacity to do work, i.e. to put matter in motion. And so energy does not have any mass. It doesn't weigh anything. It doesn't take up any space. But we know that the more energy you use up, the more work you can do. And that work could come in all sorts of forms. Maybe it's making this cheetah run, or maybe it's pushing a ball down the hill, or maybe it's getting a metabolic reaction in the body to happen. So everything that happens in the body requires energy. Everything. We can't survive without energy. And as soon as you're dead, the energy supply gets cut off, game over. And all the metabolic reactions cease to exist, and therefore the organism ceases to exist as an organism. Now, we can break energy down into two categories. Kinetic energy is the energy of motion. So you see here, this person has actually pushed the ball and the ball is rolling down the hill. Therefore, there is an energy of motion going on here. And when you're having kinetic energy going on, energy is also going to be lost to the system in the form of heat. Now, the opposite of kinetic energy is potential energy. And this would be like what's going on when the ball's at the top of the hill before it started rolling down. It's full of potential energy. It has the potential to do work, but that energy hasn't been activated into kinetic energy. So potential energy is stored energy. Kinetic energy is the energy of motion. So for the body and for the bodies of all organisms, it's really important to harness multiple kinds of energy. And so in the body, we see chemical energy, electrical energy, and mechanical energy. And we also make use of something called electromagnetic energy or radiant energy. So chemical energy is the energy that's stored in chemical bonds between atoms. And one of the things our body constantly does with metabolic reactions is we are constantly breaking bonds and reforming bonds. And when we break the bonds, we release energy, and that energy allows us to do work, to carry out those metabolic reactions, and therefore to live. Electrical energy is where you get energy from the movement of charged particles. So this is also really critical to how the body functions, because we talked a little bit about sodium and potassium and sodium and chlorine. And so these chemical ions, which we'll talk about later in this lecture, are in constant movement across cell membranes. And because of the potential energy due to electrical differences, it keeps things moving. For example, you'll learn later that the way a neuron functions, the way we get messages from the brain to our muscles, is through the movement of ions due to electrical energy, the movement of charged particles. Mechanical energy would involve the actual moving of matter, so you could think of flexing your muscles. And electromagnetic energy is energy that travels in waves, things like light, for example. So the way your eye functions is very in tune to what's going on with the electromagnetic spectrum, light coming in and how it refracts into different wavelengths of light. So just like matter, you can't create it or destroy it, but you can transform it from one kind of energy to another. So for example, the electromagnetic energy released by the sun in the form of light can be harnessed by solar panels and converted therefore into electrical energy that could heat your house or keep the lights on. We could also take that electromagnetic energy from the sun and turn it into chemical energy through the process of photosynthesis when you grow a garden. Or mechanical energy, take wind and convert it into electrical energy with turbines, with windmills. And we could also, for example, take electrical energy and turn it into mechanical energy, like the spinning of a motor. Okay, so we've been talking a lot about these atoms, these 118 elements of the periodic table, 92 of which are natural. So how do we know? How do we know what an atom looks like, and what does it in fact look like? So some of this comes about through theoretical work of physicists and chemists that we're not going to get into. That's beyond our scope. But I want you to know the basics of what an atom looks like, how it's set up, and you know what properties it has, because this is going to be important for knowing how atoms interact with each other, which is vital to understand how metabolic reactions of the body occur. So if you think of an atom like a sphere, it's hard to draw a sphere on a two-dimensional picture, so we're going to show it in two dimensions, but just keep in mind an atom really is a sphere. And it's made up of subatomic particles. And then those particles themselves could be made up of things, but again, outside the scope of what we're talking about. But the main part of subatomic particles I want you to know about are protons, neutrons, and electrons. So protons have a positive charge. Makes sense, right? You think of a word like proactive. That sounds like something positive, right? So that means you're doing something good. So protons have a positive charge. We'll abbreviate them with a little p. And they're found in the center of the atom, or the atom's nucleus. And the number of protons an element has is what gives that element its number on the periodic table. So hydrogen, for example, is element number one, and it's because it has one proton in its nucleus. If we look here, there's two different models shown here for how to represent an atom. The kind of easy to draw one, but more outdated, is what's called the planetary model. And that you would show the number of protons in the nucleus, as well as the number of neutrons that we'll talk about in 1 second. And then you'll have orbiting around that nucleus in different shells, the electrons, which we'll talk about as well. The orbital model is what's shown here, where it looks a little cloudy, and that has to do with the electrons, which we'll talk about in 1 second. So for now, just know protons are found in the center, the nucleus of the atom, and they carry a positive charge. Now, the neutrons are found also in the nucleus with the protons, but they carry no charge. They are neutral. Neutrons, neutral. And we're going to abbreviate those with a little n. And finally, let's get to the electrons. So the electrons are so much smaller than protons and neutrons, and they are not found in the nucleus. They're found orbiting the nucleus, and they carry a negative charge. And let's abbreviate electrons with a little e. So electrons carry a negative charge, and if you've ever played with magnets or batteries, you know that positive and negative attract each other. So the negatively charged electrons are orbiting about the nucleus of the atom, and they're attracted to the positive charge of the nucleus in the center of the atom. So this keeps them moving around like crazy. And they're so fast, they're so small and so fast that they never stay in one place for any length of time. And so in the planetary model, you see these electrons looking like they're, you know, in one fixed point, but really the reality is they're a cloud. They're moving so fast you can never see anyone at any one period of time. It's just a cloud of movement around that nucleus. You can kind of think of this like if you take a pencil and you start waving it up and down. If you ever tried this trick as a kid, you'll remember that the pencil will start looking like it's made out of rubber, and you can't really see it at any one point. You see what looks like a cloud going by because it's moving so fast. So same thing with the electrons orbiting the nucleus of the atom. So in this case, this atom that's shown here has two electrons and two protons. So we would know that that's element number two of the periodic table, which happens to be helium. So helium has two protons, therefore it's element number two of the periodic table. Here's our hydrogen down here. This is element number one. It has one proton in the middle, and it has one electron. So that one electron is just orbiting around. So here's the planetary model. Here's the orbital model. Now notice hydrogen does not have any neutrons. We'll explain why that is in just a sec. And finally, let's just look at carbon here. So carbon is element number six on the periodic table. So right off the bat, we know it's going to have six protons in its nucleus. It also has six neutrons, and it's going to have six electrons orbiting that nucleus. Now you'll see here those electrons do not appear in the same rings or the same shells, and we'll talk about why that is just 1 sec, so stay with me. But in general, when you find an element on the periodic table in its natural state, the number of protons is going to equal the number of electrons. That's going to change when we make something called ions, which we'll talk about later in the lecture. So let's take a little closer look at how the atoms are designated on the periodic table. How do we know which atom is which? So let's take a look at carbon. So remember, here's carbon on the periodic table, element number 6. So it looks something like this. Now you'll see two numbers here, which are very important and give us a lot of information. So for carbon, the letter here is called its chemical symbol. So for carbon, it has to be a C for carbon. B would be boron, H is hydrogen. Sometimes the chemical symbol doesn't seem to match the name, like sodium here is Na, but that has to do with the Latin name for sodium. So we got the chemical symbol is the letter. The number up here, and depending on the periodic table you're using, it could occur in different locations. Sometimes it's in the corner, sometimes it might even be at the bottom. Just depends on the periodic table you're using. In this example, the number is above the chemical symbol. So carbon is element number 6. That 6, we've already said, tells you the number of protons. So carbon has 6 protons. But that number has a name. It's called the atomic number. So carbon is atomic number 6, and that tells us the number of protons in the nucleus of the atom. So in this representation, the atomic number happens to be written at the bottom. Now there's a number here, another number that you definitely want to pay attention to, and in most periodic tables it occurs as a decimal. Now in this representation, they rounded it to a whole number, but most of the time you'll see it as a decimal. This is called the mass number. So you could think of the mass number as being the mass of the nucleus of the atom. So it's the protons and the neutrons together give it the bulk of its mass. The decimal comes from the mass of the electrons. They're so lightweight, they hardly weigh anything, but they're reflected in the decimal. But the protons and the neutrons are going to give you the mass of the nucleus, which is the mass number. So the mass number is telling you the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. And you could just do some quick math depending on what information you're looking for. So let's say I had the mass number and I had the atomic number. How could I figure out how many neutrons that atom has? So all you're gonna do is take the mass number and round it, so 12.01, so let's say 12. That tells us the number of neutrons plus protons. Subtract the atomic number, which tells us the number of protons, and what you'll get is the number of neutrons. So in the case of carbon, 12 minus 6 gives you 6 neutrons. So lots of information contained in what you have there. So that planetary model we were looking at can lead us to draw atoms in what's called a Bohr shell diagram. And Bohr shells are great because they're simple and they give a lot of information about the electrons of an atom. So I pointed out these rings or these shells that orbit the nucleus of the atom that contain the electrons, and that you have different numbers of shells depending on the atom that you're talking about. So these shells are also called valence shells or orbital shells. And they can give you information about how likely it is that that atom is going to bond to another atom or another molecule or compound. So it tells you what's going on with the valence electrons. So the valence electrons are the electrons in the outermost shell of the atom. And they're also the electrons that are going to have the most energy. They are so excited because they're furthest away from the nucleus, they don't know what to do. So they're full of energy, and therefore they're going to be ready to react with other atoms if they're not happy, which we'll explain what we mean in a second. Now there's a couple of rules you need to know when you're working with Bohr shell diagrams, when you're drawing them, for example, and that is the maximum number of electrons that any one of those shells can hold. So the very first shell around the nucleus of the atom can hold a maximum of 2 electrons. And that's for every atom in the periodic table. The first shell holds a maximum of 2 electrons. It can hold 1, but what it really wants is 2. So in the case of hydrogen, for example, remember hydrogen is element number 1. It only has 1 electron. And so it only has 1 valence shell. And there's that electron going around in the valence shell, it's not happy, it's not stable, because that shell wants 2 electrons, but it only has 1. So that's gonna make hydrogen ion very reactive. It's gonna want to do something to fill that outer shell. So first rule, first shell holds max of 2 electrons. Second shell. So if you have more than 2 electrons, the electrons are going to start going into the second shell. And so the second shell can hold a maximum of 8 electrons. And that's what it wants. It wants to fill that second shell with 8 electrons. If it doesn't have enough electrons to fill that 8, it's going to be a reactive element, a reactive atom, and it's going to want to bond with other things. So let's take the example of carbon here. So recall that carbon is element number 6. 6 protons in the nucleus, and it also happened to have 6 neutrons, and it has 6 electrons. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the first 2 electrons of those 6 and fill that first shell. So remember, the first shell can hold a max of 2 electrons. So there's 2. Well, it had 6, so that leaves 4 left over, right? 6 minus 2 is 4. So we're going to take those other 4 electrons and put them in the second valence shell. But recall that that second shell can hold a max of 8. So it wants 4 more. It only has 4 in there, but the max is 8. So it's looking for 4 more electrons. And that's going to lead to this atom wanting to bond with other atoms to fill that outer shell. Here's nitrogen, which is element number 7. So that means 2 electrons in the first shell, leaving 5 left over to make 7. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But again, that second shell can hold a max of 8, so it's missing 3 electrons. It's going to look for getting those 3 electrons somehow by bonding with other things. We have down here oxygen, which is element number 8. So that means 2 in the first shell and 6 in the second shell. So it's missing 2 that it wants. And here's phosphorus and here's sulfur. So notice in the case of phosphorus and sulfur, we've actually gone out to a third shell. So this is how you construct a Bohr shell model, and this will be very helpful in trying to figure out how things bond together. So what we've just been talking about these atoms wanting to fill that outermost valence shell with the appropriate number of electrons, 2 if it's the first shell, 8 if it's the second shell, etc., that desire, if you will, of course these things don't have consciousness, but that desire of these atoms to fill its outermost valence shell with the valence electrons is called the octet rule. It's also called the rule of 8s because these guys want 8 electrons in that second shell or in the third shell. And so if they don't have that 8, or in the case of the first shell, it wants 2, if it doesn't get what it wants, then it's going to be reactive. It's going to want to bond to other things. So remember, 2 electrons for hydrogen and helium, 8 electrons for all the others. So if they don't get what they want in that outer shell, they're going to be looking to bond to another atom or compound. And they do that by either transferring one or more electrons or sharing electrons with somebody else. And we'll talk about exactly how that is done in a little bit. But that's how bonding is formed. That's how chemical bonds are created, that store that chemical energy that can later be broken and released to cause work to be done in our bodies. So a little bit about helium and some of its little cousins here. So if we look in the furthermost right column of the periodic table, this is a special column of elements called the noble gases. And these noble gases, I call them happy campers because they have already fulfilled their octet rule. They have all the electrons in their outermost shell that they want, and therefore they are not reactive. They're not looking to bond with anything else. So for example, helium right here is element number 2. So it has 2 electrons. And as we know, that first shell holds a max of 2 electrons. So it fills its one and only shell. It's happy. It's stable. It's not reactive. The other noble gases going down the column, like neon, argon, krypton, xenon, etc., radon, these are also noble gases. And if you were to draw out the Bohr shell diagram, you'll find out that their outermost valence shell is filled, they're happy, they're not reactive. And so I always thought this was funny because if you've ever watched the old Superman movies or series, the only thing that could hurt Superman was kryptonite. And so here's a little girl holding some kryptonite and Superman's all scared. But kryptonite is made of krypton. Well, krypton is a noble gas, so it wouldn't be reactive. So how in the world could it hurt Superman? That's something I've always pondered. But we know it's a noble gas. Its outermost valence shell is filled, so it would not react with Superman. Now, there's a lot of other cool stuff about the periodic table, and if you take a chemistry class, you'll get into all the interesting codes and clues that are found in the periodic table. But we're going to point out two of the cool things about the periodic table that will make your life a lot easier when you're trying to draw Bohr shell diagrams or trying to figure out how atoms would bond together. And this has to do with the periodic table telling you how many valence shells an atom's going to have and how many electrons are going to be in that outermost shell. And this is by looking at two things that the periodic table tells us about, and that is the period number and the group number. Now, depending on the periodic table you get hold of, it may or may not have numbers going down the side and across that tell you what period an element is in or what group number an element is in. But this one does. And so if you look here, let's look at hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium. Notice these numbers here. Those numbers are the period number. So that tells us what row the element is in. So you can see hydrogen and going across here to helium are both in period one, which means row one. Lithium, beryllium, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, and neon. These guys are all in the second row, so period number two. And sodium, magnesium, you know, aluminum, phosphorus, sulfur, etc. These guys are in period number three, row number three. So that period number is awesome because what it tells us is the number of valence shells. And you can check it by drawing out a Bohr diagram and you're going to see, wow, this just made your life so much easier because a hydrogen is period number one, and that means it's going to have one valence shell. And lo and behold, it does. And so does helium, that is also in period number one. Sodium, skipping down here, sodium and magnesium are in period number three. And if you do the Bohr shell diagram, you'll see that they have three valence shells. So this can save you some drawing if you just look at what period number the element's in. And then it's also important to look at the column that the element is in. So elements in the same column, I call them cousins because they share a lot of the same chemical properties and predictability about their reactivity. So these columns are called the group number. And the group number is going to tell us how many electrons are in the outermost valence shell. So the number of valence electrons. And notice that in this table, it numbers them straight across from 1 to 18. Some periodic tables don't use the teens here. They just use the ones place. So this would be group 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And so when you're trying to figure out the number of electrons in the outermost shell, just look at the ones place here. Just ignore the tens place for our purposes. So for example, let's look at fluorine and chlorine and bromine here. So these guys are in group number 17, so we can say 7, and that tells us how many electrons are in the outermost valence shell. So fluorine and chlorine and bromine and iodine, all these guys are going to have 7 electrons in their outermost valence shell. And going on the other side, sodium, potassium, lithium, hydrogen, these guys are all group one elements and they all have one electron in their outermost shell. So pretty cool. If you can understand what a period number is and what a group number is, you're going to be able to look at the periodic table and right away without having to draw a Bohr shell diagram, you're going to know how many valence shells it has and how many electrons are in that outermost valence shell. Super convenient, right? Now, we've been talking about Bohr shell diagrams and, you know, you can draw these, right? So you draw the nucleus with the number of protons and neutrons in there, and then you look at the periodic table to figure out how many valence shells there are and how many electrons are in the outermost shell, and of course you fill up the electrons in the other shells. It can get a little messy if you're trying to draw a bunch of these on a paper and you're trying to figure out how these atoms are going to interact with each other to bond. You know, it can get a little messy on your paper. So there's another way to draw atoms that I personally think is a lot cleaner and easier for me, but you choose whichever one you like. And these are called Lewis dot structures, and they're kind of fun. So what you do to make a Lewis dot structure is you take the chemical symbol, so H if it's hydrogen, C if it's carbon, or Cl if it's chlorine, and then what you do is you draw dots that represent the valence electrons, the electrons in the outermost shell, which again, you can find that out through the periodic table. Just look what group number the elements then, and it'll tell you the number of electrons in the outermost shell. So hydrogen is, of course, element number one, so it's going to have one electron. And so I would just draw a big H here, and then I'm going to draw one dot to represent that one valence electron. Helium has two electrons because it's element number two, so I'd write He and then two electrons. Boron has three valence electrons. So I would then, what I do is you want to do one dot on each side. So imagine the chemical symbol has four sides to it. So the B has four sides. So I'd write one here, one here, one here. This shows that I have three unpaired electrons. So what these electrons in the valence shell are going to like to do is they like to pair up. And so three is an odd number, so you can just say these guys are not paired. They're going to be three lone or unpaired electrons. Carbon has four in its outermost shell. It's group four element, so one, two, three, four. But then once you get into higher numbers of valence electrons, you're going to start pairing them up. So let's take a look at chlorine. So chlorine is element number 17. So it's going to have seven electrons in its outermost shell. So we're going to start to see how we can pair these guys up. So seven electrons, what we're going to do is we're going to go around the clock, drawing one electron on each side at a time until it goes back on itself, in which case we'll start pairing them up. So we're going to go one, two, three, four, five. So it's now a pair, six, seven. And so you can see for chlorine, it has, you know, three pairs and one lone electron. So that one lone electron is problematic for this chlorine. This is what makes him unstable. Remember, he wants to satisfy that octet rule. So he wants four pairs of electrons, i.e. eight electrons in his outermost shell. This one's unpaired. So you know that this is where it's going to be looking to try to find another electron by bonding with another atom. Now remember, neon is a noble gas, it's that group 8 element, so it already has its octet rule fulfilled, so it has 8 electrons in its outermost valence shell, so it's going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So the idea is you're just going to go around until you've satisfied all those pairs and run out of electrons. So let's see if I can try one here with my trackpad here. So the chemical symbol for lithium is Li. And lithium happens to be in period 2 and group 1. So we know it's going to have two valence shells with one electron in its outermost shell. And it happens to be element number 3. So that tells us there's going to be three protons in the middle. And so let's go ahead and draw our shell. So here's our first shell. And we know that that one's going to have two electrons, so it's filled its first valence shell, but as we said, it's period 2, so we know that it's going to have two valence shells, so we're going to draw the second one around here. Sorry, my circle's not perfect here. And it's group 1, so we know it's going to have one electron in its outermost shell. So that would be the Bohr diagram of it, but let's draw a Lewis dot structure. So for a Lewis dot, I'm just going to take the chemical symbol, and I'm just going to write the electron that's in the outermost shell. So this one's easy. I'm just going to write one dot right there. So notice it's unpaired, so this is going to be a reactive element. Let's try one more Lewis dot structure. We'll skip over the Bohr this time, and because I don't want to bore you, huh? No, we're just going to do the Lewis dot structure. So let's take a different one. Let's try fluorine here. So fluorine, of course, is element number 9, and it's in group 17, so we know it's going to have 7 electrons in its outermost shell. And it's in period 2, so we know it's going to have two shells. So fluorine is an F. And we said it's period 2, so it's going to have two shells. And we said it's in group 17, so it's going to have 7 electrons in its outer shell. So we're going to skip over that first, the first ring, the first valence shell. We don't even need to worry about that. Let's just look at the number of valence electrons in its outermost shell, and we know it's going to be 7. So we're going to start going 1. I'm going to go to the second side, 2. 3, 4, but we got to get to 7, so now we start pairing up. 5, 6, 7, and so you see that there ends up being one lone electron there, so it's going to be very reactive, and fluorine's in the same group as chlorine, so notice that the way the Lewis dot structure is the same in chlorine and fluorine. They both have the same kind of reactivity, that they're missing that one electron to fill the outermost shell. So that's a Lewis dot structure, very handy to use to just kind of predict what's going to happen with these atoms. So now that we know how atoms work and how the number of electrons in the outermost shell predicts how that atom is going to react with other atoms. Is it going to form a bond in the case of most of them, or is it going to be happy camper and not want a bond in the case of the noble gases? So for those that are not happy, they have the need to gain or lose electrons to fill that octet role, we are going to call those kinds of atoms ions, the ones that have gained or lost the electrons. So once they have done the deed of trying to make themselves happy, they are called ions. So ions are formed when atoms gain or lose electrons. So let's take an example with sodium. So recall that sodium is element number 11. It's Na is its chemical symbol, and it's a group 1 element. So we know that it's going to have one lone electron in its outermost shell. And we can do the Bohr diagram like this. So if it has 11 protons, it also has 11 electrons when it's in its neutral elemental state on the periodic table. So if we take the first two of those 11, we say two electrons in the first shell, that leaves 9. So then we have 9 out here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we have 2 plus 8, that's 10. That leaves that last electron in the third shell, the outermost shell. Well, that outermost shell wants 8. It has 1, so it's going to be looking for 7 more electrons to fill. It's going to be very difficult for it to find somebody willing to give it 7 more electrons. It's a lot easier for that sodium just to kick out that lone electron and give it to somebody else. That would leave it with 8 in the second shell, make it much happier and much more stable. So that's what it's going to be looking to do, is to create a sodium ion by losing that electron and giving it to somebody who wants it. So once it has lost that outermost electron, it becomes a sodium ion. And we're going to illustrate that as Na with a little plus sign superscript to indicate that it has lost a negative charge. It has lost an electron. Now, this tends to kind of confuse people how losing an electron would make you a positively charged ion. So I like to think of this as, imagine you're having a really bad day. You're full of negative energy, just full of negativity. And then you go to a yoga class, you stretch, you get happy because you've given your negative energy into the universe, and therefore you become a more positive person. So you've become a positive ion. So if you lose one negative charge by losing one electron, it's essentially like gaining one positive charge. You become a positively charged sodium ion with 11 protons, but only 10 electrons. So notice at this point that sodium ion carries a charge, and in this case it's a positive charge. So ions are atoms or molecules with a charge, either some kind of positive charge or some kind of negative charge. And so specifically, sodium would be what we call a cation because it's a positively charged ion. I think of this as, my cat makes me happy, I get positive. So cations are positively charged ions. The opposite of a cation would be an anion. That is a negatively charged ion. So we can see this with the element chlorine. So remember that chlorine was missing an electron from its outermost shell. It had 7 in its outermost shell. It had one unpaired electron. So to give away 7 is going to be very difficult to find another atom that wants to take those 7. So instead of giving away the 7, like sodium gave away its 1, instead, it's looking to accept one electron from another atom. And that works perfectly because just so happens that sodium has one to give. So sodium's going to give away an electron, and chlorine is going to accept that electron to fill its octet role. And therefore, they're going to form a bond, specifically something called an ionic bond, because they have now each become ions and formed a bond in the process. So in that scenario, chlorine has become a negative ion because it accepted extra negativity. So it becomes an anion. Sodium gave away a bit of negativity, so it became a cation. So ionic bonds are attractions between anions and cations. And these ionic compounds that form as the result of that bonding are also called salts, which makes sense, right? In this example, because sodium and chlorine together, when they bond, they form table salt, NaCl. So let's take what's on this diagram, which shows this process of sodium transferring one electron to chlorine so that both have their octets filled, and that creates sodium chloride. Let's see it actually in action. So this little instant replay of animation will show you how sodium and chlorine come together to create sodium ion and chlorine ion, which come together to make table salt. So notice here the transferring of the electron from sodium to chlorine. So that is what makes this an ionic bond. So by definition, ionic bonds form when there is a transferring of one or more electrons. We're going to contrast this in a little bit with another kind of bonding where there's a sharing. But in the case of ionic, there's a transferring. So we've taken that lone electron of sodium because it wanted to kick it out so that it would have the octet role fulfilled through its second shell. And we're going to give it transfer it to chlorine, who is missing one, and therefore that will fulfill chlorine's octet role. And by helping each other out like that, they will form crystals of table salt. So watch here. There's the electron, and see if you can watch it transfer to chlorine, and then they form sodium chloride. So that's how ionic bonding works. So now you know that ionic bonding deals with the transfer of one or more electrons between atoms to form an ionic bond. But sometimes giving away or taking an electron or more is not going to satisfy the octet role for both atoms, and in which case a different kind of bonding might be better. And this is called covalent bonding. And I have a Barney the Purple Dinosaur here because for all of you Barney fans, Barney was about sharing is caring, right? And that's what covalent bonding is all about. It's sharing of electrons. And by sharing the electrons, both atoms end up filling their octet role. So think of covalent as like cooperation. They work together. So let's take a simple example with hydrogen gas, H2. So remember that hydrogen is element number one, so it has only one electron. Well, it has one valence shell, and remember that one shell wants two, but it only has one. So it's going to be reactive. It's looking to find that other electron. Here comes another hydrogen atom. It also has one electron, and it's also looking for one more electron. Well, it wouldn't be fair if one gave its electron to the other, or the other one has two, and now that one has zero. So instead, what if they shared each of their lone electrons, and then they'd both be happy? And here's how that works. So if they come together, they're each lone electrons, that can now form a pair. And remember, we said they like to be in pairs. And so imagine they come together now. Here's that one's electron and here's that one's electron. Let's go ahead and cover up one of these electrons and count how many electrons that other one now has. So this hydrogen on the left now has one, two electrons. Now imagine covering up the one on the left and looking at the one on the right. This one on the right now has one, two electrons. So now by sharing their lone electrons, they have now made both of them happy. They both now have their octet role fulfilled. Same thing with chlorine. Here's chlorine gas, which is toxic. You don't want to be around that. But recall that chlorine is element number 17. It's in the group 17, and it has seven electrons in its outermost shell. So using the Lewis dot structure here, recall that there's one lone electron that's missing an electron. It's not happy. It wants to fulfill its octet rule by gaining another electron. And here's another chlorine, same thing. It's missing an electron. So what if they just shared their lone electrons here and see if it makes both of them happy? So now we have Cl2, chlorine gas. So cover up the one on the right for a sec. Let's look at the one on the left. And now we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's filled its octet rule. It has eight electrons now in its outermost shell, and it's a happy camper. Now cover up the one on the left. Let's look at the chlorine on the right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It now has eight electrons in its outermost valence shell, It's also a happy camper. So now we've made two happy elements by sharing their lone electrons. So that's called covalent bonding. Sharing truly is caring. Now, what we just saw with the examples of hydrogen gas and chlorine gas is that these, in each of these situations, you were dealing with molecules, right? Two elements that are the same. So hydrogen gas, they bonded covalently and they were both the same element. So imagine these guys are playing tug of war. Because hydrogen is the same thing as another hydrogen, these guys are gonna have equal electronegativity. They have the same pull on those electrons. And therefore, those electrons are gonna spend approximately an equal amount of time around each of those hydrogens. So it's an equally matched tug of war. Now here's chlorine. Chlorine has a larger electronegativity than hydrogen. It's a heavier element. But both of these in this case are chlorine. We're dealing with chlorine gas, Cl2. So just like with the hydrogens, these guys are having an equally matched tug of war on those valence electrons. And therefore, these electrons are going to spend an equal amount of time around both chlorines. So because in both examples of hydrogen gas and chlorine gas, these guys have two of the same element, the tug of war is matched, the electronegativity of the two elements is matched, and therefore this is what we call a nonpolar covalent bond. There's no polarity to the pull of the electrons. The electrons are evenly matched. They're going to spend an equal amount of time on all parts of both atoms. Let's contrast that with what's called a polar covalent bond. So here is Mickey Mouse upside down. Here's a water molecule, H2O, right? So we have two atoms of hydrogen, one atom of oxygen being the face of Mickey Mouse. And the way water is formed, so recall that hydrogen each hydrogen has one electron in its valence shell. Recall that oxygen has six electrons in its outermost shell. So oxygen's looking for two more. Each of those hydrogens is looking for one more. So it's gonna be the same kind of thing. We're not gonna transfer any electrons. It's not gonna be ionic. They're gonna share, but oxygen is a lot more electronegative than hydrogen is. So it's not gonna be an even tug of war match. That oxygen is going to pull way harder on those electrons than either of those hydrogens can pull. It's not a fair race. And so the electrons are gonna spend a lot more time around the oxygen than they do the hydrogen. That's gonna give a little bit more negative charge to the oxygen and a little less negative charge to the hydrogens. And so hydrogens are gonna maintain what's called a partial positive charge, and the oxygen's gonna maintain a partial negative charge. And so because it's not neutral, because the electrons like to spend more time around the oxygen than they do the hydrogen, because it's more electronegative, it's bigger, we are going to create a polar covalent bond. So let's take another example. So we have here hydrogen fluoride, HF, very reactive. And notice here that fluorine is in group 7, whereas hydrogen is in group 1. So hydrogen is very small, it only has one electron. Fluorine is element number 9, and it's going to have 7 electrons in its outermost shell. So it's not going to be an ionic bond. Hydrogen's not going to just give away its electron. They're going to have to share, just like we saw with hydrogen gas and with chlorine gas. So they're going to share their electrons. That way, by hydrogen sharing its one electron, it gets the 2 it needs, and fluorine gets the 8 it needs by sharing its outermost electron. But because fluorine is so much bigger, it's so much more electronegative, the electrons are going to spend a lot more time around the fluorine than they do the hydrogen. And that's why we draw this bigger cloud around fluorine than we do hydrogen. It becomes like a teardrop-shaped look here in terms of how the electrons are going to move. And so fluorine is going to have a lot more electrons at any given moment in time, so it's going to maintain a partial negative charge. And this little Greek symbol here indicates partial. So fluorine will have a partial negative charge because the electrons spend more time around it, and the hydrogen will maintain a partial positive charge because the electrons spend less time around it than they do the fluorine. So this would be an example of a polar covalent bond. You can see the polarity here. It's not equal. It's not an equal tug of war match. Now, let's go back to that hydrogen gas that we talked about in just a little bit. Now, because there's two hydrogens, they're going to form one kind of covalent bond between them. And so we can use what's called a line diagram to illustrate this. So when we were using the Lewis dot structures, recall that each hydrogen had a single dot, and then they bond covalently and they share each of their electrons. So you draw two dots or one pair. Well, in a line diagram, instead of drawing dots, we're going to say that each pair of electrons is one line. So hydrogen gas, H2, is going to be H line H. And so that shows you that they are sharing one pair of electrons, and that is called a single covalent bond. Down here is oxygen. So recall that oxygen has two lone electrons, if you were to do the Lewis dot structure here. And so it's actually going to share, you know, those two lones are going to form a bond, and these two lones are going to form a bond. So it actually is going to have two pairs of electrons that it shares. And so in a line diagram, we're going to draw that as two lines. So O, two lines, and then an O. So that would be oxygen gas. Because there's two pairs shared, that's called a double covalent bond. And we could draw another one. You could have, for example, nitrogen. So here's two nitrogens, nitrogen gas, which is most of what we breathe. Nitrogen is element number 7. And so it's going to have 5 electrons in its outermost shell. So if we did the Lewis, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it has one pair there. And here's the other one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it has one pair there. So only for each of those, only one is a pair. The rest are all lone electrons. So these guys are going to want to pair up. So it's going to be a little weird to draw, but let's say this one pairs with this lone one over here. So those guys form one covalent bond. And then maybe these guys, that one bonds over here. So that's two covalent bonds. And this last set of lone electrons are going to pair up. So we have 3 covalent bonds. So if we did the line diagram, we're going to draw this with 3 lines because there's 3 pairs shared between these two nitrogens. And so that is our nitrogen gas in 2, but that right there would be a triple covalent bond because they're sharing 3 pairs of electrons. So I think you get how that notation goes there. So let's just talk a little more about structural formulas and different ways of representing molecules and compounds. So I just showed you hydrogen gas, H2, oxygen gas, O2. I showed you nitrogen gas, N2. So the little 2 subscript there means that you have 2 atoms of that element. So 2 atoms of hydrogen here, 2 atoms of oxygen, or I showed you N2 would be 2 atoms of nitrogen. I showed you chlorine gas before, Cl2, that's 2 atoms of chlorine. Of course, you can have different numbers, you get a different compound. I showed you the structural formula where you show the number of pairs of electrons shared between the two elements. And we draw it with a line. So this is the structural formula for hydrogen gas. Here's the structural formula for oxygen gas. Recall it that they shared 2 pairs of electrons. So we draw 2. And then I wanted to show you the space filling model because this is more, it's closer to what it really would look like. So recall that we said atoms are spheres. They are not 2-dimensional structures just drawn on a piece of paper. They are spheres because the electrons are constantly orbiting the nucleus. So if you were to draw a more realistic structure for what hydrogen gas looks like, it would look something like this, kind of like 2 bubbles illustrating the 2 hydrogen atoms there. Oxygen is a larger element, bigger mass number, and more electronegative. So we would just draw bigger spheres to represent the 2 oxygens. So 3 different ways of representing the same molecule in this case, molecular formula, structural formula, and space filling model. Okay, so up until now, we've been talking about ions, ionic bonding, covalent bonding. Well, all of those, we're talking about the electrons and what the electron behavior is and what the atoms are trying to do in terms of sharing or transferring electrons. Now we're going to focus on the neutrons. So sometimes you can have an atom of the periodic table gain neutrons over time. So the number of protons stays the same, because if you change the number of protons or the atomic number, you change the element that you're talking about. So we're going to keep the same number of protons, keep the same atomic number, but now we're going to look at what happens over time when atoms start gaining neutrons. And in that case, these atoms become isotopes. Iso means same, topes means type. So isotopes are atoms with the same number of protons, but different number of neutrons. So because they are gaining neutrons, but keeping their protons the same, we're going to be changing the mass number. These guys are going to be gaining in mass. The nucleus is going to get heavier because they're gaining neutrons. So example of this, carbon. So the kind of carbon that makes up most of the carbon in our cells, or makes up most of the carbon in the environment, is what's called carbon 12, right? It's that carbon that has a mass number of 12.01 that we talked about before. And as we said, that carbon is gonna have six protons, it's atomic number six. It's gonna have six neutrons and six electrons in its elemental state. So this would be the normal or neutral kind of carbon. But over time, and sometimes with some of these elements, we're talking millions of years. Other elements, we're talking about maybe just a fraction of a second. In the case of carbon, it's going to take probably millions of years, but eventually that carbon is going to undergo what we call radioactive decay. It's going to pick up one or more neutrons over time. The longer the time goes by, the more neutrons it picks up. And so over time, that carbon is going to pick up an extra neutron. So instead of having six neutrons, it will have seven neutrons. And remember that the mass number is the number of protons plus neutrons. So now instead of being carbon 12 with a mass number of 12.01, it's going to be carbon 13, because six protons plus seven neutrons gives us a mass number of about 13. So it's going to become carbon 13, which is radioactive. And given more time, it'll decay further and pick up yet another neutron. And instead of seven neutrons, it'll end up with eight neutrons. Six plus eight is 14. That becomes carbon 14, radioactive. And this has all sorts of uses in biology and the healthcare field. So carbon 14 dating is used by biologists, for example, to figure out how old, or estimate how old a fossil is. But these things can also be used in the healthcare field, which we'll talk about in a second. So a radioactive isotope, also called a radioisotope, are isotopes that decay or decompose to more stable forms by gaining neutrons. And so they have a nucleus that's highly unstable, and therefore they're ready to give off particles, which is also known as radioactivity. So in medicine, we can use radioisotopes as tracers to try to trace what's going on in the body and figure out what the problem is. So this is very, very useful. It's a valuable tool in research and in the treatment of disease and the diagnosis of disease. So for example, if you're trying to screen for thyroid disease, you might give a person an isotope, a radioisotope of iodine, iodine-123. And because the thyroid takes up iodine, it doesn't really care whether it's radioactive iodine or whether it's regular iodine. And so it'll take that tracer, that radioisotope of iodine, take it up, and it'll fluoresce under the machinery, and you'll be able to see how the uptake of iodine is working in the thyroid to diagnose if there's thyroid disease going on. It can be used for other things. And in fact, in the treatment and diagnosis of cancer, we use radioisotopes. Now, the caveat of that is, because we're dealing with radioactive elements, they also come with risks and could actually cause some of the things we're worried about, like cancer, because they can damage tissue. So it's kind of a balancing act between the benefits of using these radioisotopes to diagnose and treat disease versus the risks that come associated with using. Okay, let's talk about mixtures versus compounds. So what you see here in this little movie is a mixture where stuff's moving around. So let's contrast what a mixture is versus what a compound is. And of course, we've been talking about compounds so far. So when we're talking about a mixture, we're talking about two or more compounds that are physically intermixed. So, you know, imagine you're putting sugar in your coffee. You have coffee and you have sugar, and you mix them together. But in mixing them together, you sort of change how that mixture looks and, of course, how it tastes. If you don't mix the sugar in your coffee, it's not going to be that sweet. But that's a physical change. There's no actual chemical bonding going on. So you could always re-separate them through different techniques. Maybe it's straining or filtering or evaporating. And these mixtures can be heterogeneous or homogeneous. And we'll talk about what we mean there in 1 second. So up to now, we've been talking about matter, anything that has mass and takes up space. And we can divide that matter into a mixture where you're having two or more elements or compounds mixed together, versus a pure substance would be like what you find in its form on the periodic table. So let's look at the pure substances. So here would be an element, maybe it's carbon or hydrogen or whatever it is. It's all the same element put together in that substance. A compound would be where you're taking two or more elements of the periodic table and chemically putting them together. So like water, right? Like H2O, you're chemically making water. It's not the same as hydrogen and oxygen next to each other. This is chemical change. They're sharing electrons. You're actually getting chemical bonding going on. Versus, let's go over here to this side and look at mixtures. So a homogeneous mixture would be where there's equal parts of two substances. Like if I had the same concentration of sugar as I do coffee in my coffee, it would be very sweet, but that would be a homogeneous mixture. Versus a heterogeneous would be where the different components are not evenly mixed together. Some might settle out. That would be a heterogeneous mixture. A compound, by contrast, is like what we said with water here. There's an actual chemical change that goes on. So you can only separate the two elements of the compound through breaking of chemical bonds. Like for water, I'd have to break the bonds between the hydrogen and the oxygen. Not true of a mixture. I just need to filter out one or the other or evaporate off something. So compounds are only homogeneous mixtures. Mixtures can be heterogeneous or homogeneous. So another way to represent that here. So here's some mixtures. This would be a heterogeneous mixture where the two different components stay kind of separate from each other. Homogeneous mixture, they're kind of evenly mixed together, but they're still physically separated from each other. You know, they're put together physically, but you can separate them physically. Whereas chemical compounds, you have to chemically break bonds. Okay, two more pieces of terminology when it comes to mixtures: solvent versus solute. So solvent is usually a liquid. It's usually present in the greater amount compared to the other one. And it's what does the dissolving. So in this little film here, this guy is taking some water and pouring it into a turquoise powder to make a blue mixture. So in this case, the water is the solvent. It's what does the dissolving. The solute is the turquoise powder. So the powder is what is dissolved. The solvent is what does the dissolving, and the solution is what results, the mixture that results from having the solute dissolved into the solvent. So in the human body, we have all sorts of cases where we have solvents and solutes and solutions. Just some quick examples here. When you're dealing with your blood sugar, the glucose in your blood would be the solute, and the blood itself, or the plasma of the blood, is the solvent. So the glucose is dissolved into the plasma of the blood, and therefore the glucose is the solute, the plasma is the solvent. Now, we just mentioned the term solution, but it turns out solutions are mixtures that have a very precise definition. And in fact, there's really three types of mixtures that we're going to talk about, and three types of mixtures that are found in the bodies of organisms, including humans. These three types are solutions, colloids, which are also called emulsions, and suspensions. So let's tackle solutions first, since we were just talking about a solution. So a true solution is homogeneous. If you look at the particles here of the solution, this could be that turquoise powder we just saw, notice that they are uniformly spaced. They tend to be small, so they're not going to fall out of solution. And this creates a solution that is pretty much transparent. And this is true of so many things in the human body. Most of the solutions in our body are true solutions. They contain either gases, other liquids, or solids as solutes that get dissolved in water. Our bodies are mostly water, right? So we have this kind of transparent stuff all over the place in our body. So true solutions look like that. Now contrast that with colloids or emulsions. These are heterogeneous. So if we look at the particles in a colloid, they tend to be larger. They are not necessarily uniformly spaced. And it creates a mixture that is cloudy. So we do find these in the human body as well. So a good example is human breast milk is a colloid. So the proteins are, you know, suspended the way you see here, producing kind of a cloudy mixture. And then the other type is a suspension. So suspensions are also heterogeneous, but they tend to settle out. So those particles are going to eventually, if you let it sit long enough, they will separate from the solvent. And therefore, you're going to have this really cloudy material here. And over time, you'll see precipitate on the bottom. So an example of this is human blood. If you let human blood sit for a while, the blood cells will settle towards the bottom of the tube if you collected the blood in a glass tube, and the plasma will stay above that. So that would be an example of a suspension. So we can express the concentration of a solute in a solution as percent solute in total solution. So how many parts of the solute are in 100 parts of solution? So often the solvent is water, including in the human body. So we could take an example. Let's say we had 10 parts salt to 90 parts water. So if you were to take, for example, a graduated cylinder and you filled it, say you had 100 milliliter graduated cylinder, you filled the first 10 milliliters with salt, and then you brought the water up to the 100 mark with 90 milliliters of water, that would be give you a 10% salt solution. So that's one way of expressing it. We often, especially in the healthcare field, we often see solute concentration described as milligrams per deciliter. So a deciliter, deci means 10. So deciliter is 1/10 of a liter. In other words, you can fit 10 deciliters into 1 liter. So you often see this. So you can see over here, this would be someone testing their blood glucose level, for example. And you'll, if you look closely, you'll see that on the picture, it says milligrams per deciliter. So if you wanted to take a reading of your normal fasting blood glucose level, you would find that it is somewhere around 80 milligrams per deciliter. So that's just another way of representing concentration of solutes. So finally, the third way to express solute concentration is through something called molarity. And we're going to abbreviate that with a capital M. So molarity is defined as the number of moles of solute for every 1 liter of solvent, or which is usually water, especially when we're talking about the human body. So coming over here, you can kind of express it as sort of an equation. Molarity equals number of moles per liters of solution, or big M equals little n, which is the number of moles, divided by volume, which is the volume of the solvent in terms of liters. Now, you may be like, what in the world is a mole? So a mole, we're not talking about the fuzzy cute little animal here. Mole is a way of expressing a large quantity of particles, or atoms in this case. So for example, if you think about going and buying donuts, you buy a dozen donuts. Well, you know that a dozen donuts is equal to 12 donuts. So a mole is kind of like that, except we're dealing with a much larger quantity of stuff here. So 1 mole is equal to the molecular weight of the particles or the atoms in whatever substance you're dealing with. So 1 mole of substance is equal to something called Avogadro's number. And Avogadro's number is 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd molecules of that substance. So instead of a dozen being 12 donuts, we're saying 1 mole is equal to 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd molecules of that substance. Now that's an astronomically huge number, trillions and trillions of molecules, because remember, molecules or atoms are so tiny, there's no way we can see them with the naked eye or even a microscope. And so by using Avogadro's number, saying, okay, 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd particles of that substance is equal to 1 mole, we can now get something that we can actually see with the naked eye. We can convert between the molecular mass of something into grams. And we can weigh out grams with our naked eye, with, you know, spoons and stuff like that, and actually be able to work with something that makes sense to us. So let's take an example. Let's say we wanted to get 1 molar solution of glucose. So glucose has the formula C6H12O6. So that means for every 6 atoms of carbon, there are 12 atoms of hydrogen and 6 atoms of oxygen. So to figure out how much glucose we would have to add to water to get a 1 molar solution, the first thing we have to do is figure out the molecular weight of that compound, of the glucose. And you do this by adding up the molecular weights or the molecular masses of all the components of that compound. So if you go back to the periodic table, you will recall that we said carbon has a molecular mass of about 12. And hydrogen has a molecular mass of about 1, and oxygen has a molecular mass of about 16. So you'd have to multiply those masses by the number of atoms of it you have. So in the case of carbon, it would be 6 times 12. Then you'd add that to the molecular mass total for hydrogen, 12 times 1, and oxygen would be 6 times 16. Add all that together, and you're going to get a molecular weight of 180.12 AMU units. So in other words, that's a measure of the mass at the molecular level. Well, that doesn't make much sense to us, but thanks to Avogadro's number, we can say 180.12 AMUs is the same thing as 180.12 grams. And grams we can weigh out. So we can take 180.12 grams of glucose, stick it in a graduated cylinder, a 1,000 milliliter or a 1 liter graduated cylinder, and add enough water to bring it up to 1 liter. And that would give us a 1 molar solution of glucose. Now, when we're dealing with the human body, because we're often dealing with such low concentrations of solutes, we usually express things not in terms of moles or molar quantities, but millimoles. So little m big m. So there's 1,000 millimoles in 1 molar solution. So hope that clarifies that. You can always do lots of fun calculation problems if you're given the molarity and the volume, but you're not given the number of moles. You would just rearrange the equation to get the quantity that you want. All right, so this concludes our chemistry basics lecture. And in the next lecture, we're going to go over biochemistry.